Hello guys, I'm Kelkschiz. Going to talk a little bit about my latest tank, the Mark 7, which you see here. Let me start off by telling you how I got the idea to build this. And basically, that idea, I got the idea to build the Mark 7. Well, of course, obviously, after I built the Mark 6, it sounds logic. It sounds very, very obvious. but what I want to tell you is the thing that makes this tank unique or different from my previous tank is that it has a self-stabilizing gun mechanism. And I got the idea to include a self-stabilizing gun mechanism after I had posted about the Mark 6 on Eurobricks. And then I got some feedback, including a guy called JM1971. And he suggested that I include, or it would be cool to include, a self-stabilizing gun mechanism. And I agreed with him. It's a very fascinating idea. I was immediately fascinated by this idea. And then I started talking about it with Tommy Styrvoky, a very well-known tank builder, about the possibility of how to implement this kind of system. And he proposed a sort of a mechanical electric system, which you can see here, or a schematic. And I really, for a long time, had already wanted to work with the EV3 brick. So I was eager to try to recreate it with the gyro sensor and the EV3 brick and try to build a self-stabilizing gun mechanism with those elements. And so a couple of months after that, I actually bought my first EV3, and I was very fascinated by this toy. So I started figuring out how to program it, because it's not very easy to program. And then actually I did a lot of other stuff, because it was a long time ago. I did some other stuff, including for instance this video about LEGO shooting mechanisms. And actually that was the start of actually building the model, because one of the shooting mechanisms I showed there was this one. And this was actually the start of building the turret. Because when I start building a turret, I start with the shooting mechanism. And then I add on the motors to make it function properly. And also to elevate it and to rotate the turret. I had a little bit of trouble getting the turret built in a way that I wanted, because the Mindstorm motors and the power function motor, there's a big difference, and that's the size. And also the power function's battery is a lot smaller than the Mindstorm's computer, which also has batteries. It's about twice the size as this. So I really wanted to make a tank that was about equal in size to the Mark 6, because I knew that it would be very difficult to provide enough power to get a bigger tank moving. I had already built some experience building bigger tanks, and they were not a big success. So I really tried to keep everything small. But it's not possible to make a turret with these large Mindstorm elements and make it as small as my previous tank. So it this became a bit bigger. And I'll show you where the motors are. So, as you can see, one over here, which does the elevation. Another one over here, which does the rotation of the turret. This is the gyro sensor. And on the other side, I have another motor, which actually powers the shooting mechanism. So that's the entire turret. It's pretty heavy. The EV3 brick is in the back here. And well, that's pretty much it. So I tried to make it as small as possible, and well, I'm quite happy with how small I managed to make it. Let me talk a little bit about how it actually functions. The EV3 brick has a program running on it, and the program runs in a loop. The loop starts with taking a sensor reading from the gyro sensor, and then it takes basically another sensor reading, and it saves both those values, and it compares them, And if the values are different, then it will adjust the barrel. So actually what the gyro sensor does is it senses the orientation, and it's actually in the turret. So it doesn't really matter if the turret is facing front or back, because it will take the reading appropriately to the gun. So whenever the tank changes its inclination, for instance, when it moves up a small incline like this, then the next time the program asks for a sensor reading from the gyro sensor, it will notice that the value is not the same anymore, and it can send an appropriate command to the motor that controls the elevation to give it a little bit of a decrease so that the barrel is level again, or depending on, of course, if the barrel was not level, but for instance, if it was raised by 5 degrees, then it will make sure that it stays at 5 degrees, right? So it takes into account where the barrel was before making the adjustment. And then, of course, when the tank moves level again, then it will again adjust. The problem with the working of the mechanism as it works at the moment is that it is moved by a linear actuator like this. It takes a lot of rotations before you get a little bit of movement from the linear actuator, and that means that it takes quite a bit of time before the motor has reached before the barrel has reached the right inclination again. And of course, in a real tank, as you can see here, that works nearly instantaneously, or that works instantaneous, right? The barrel always stays aimed at the target. And in my tank, obviously, there is quite a big lag between the hull moving and the barrel moving to keep its aim. So that's something I really would like to improve in the next version of this tank. And I'm looking forward. I have some ideas about how I can actually make that work better or faster. I'm not sure if I can ever create it as accurately or function as smoothly as in an actual tank, because I do have to work with a lot of limitations, of course. Right, so let's move to that's pretty much all I wanted to say about the turret. Of course, I have a lot of different videos that explain a lot more about the shooting mechanism and how I built tanks, so please check out my other videos if you're interested in that. So now I would like to talk a little bit about my design philosophy for building LEGO tanks. And that is because it's a little bit different from what other LEGO builders have. For instance, you may know builders like Sariel and Tommy Styrvoky, and they make a lot of epic LEGO mocs, amongst which LEGO tanks. And when they do that, they mostly build models of existing tanks. And they do that in a very detailed way. And I have a huge amount of respect for what they do. But that's not quite what I'm doing. What I'm doing is I'm trying to recreate the functions of a tank. So for me, it's very important that when I build a LEGO tank, that it functions like an actual tank. So it need and for me, tanks are powerful. They are fast. They shoot. They have a powerful gun. And when I create a LEGO tank, I would like it to have those things. The design philosophy I have can be summarized by the phrase "form follows function." And it's a phrase you may have heard. It basically means that the shape of the tank is adapted to the functions. And you can clearly see that, for instance, in the way I made the hull. Some people have mentioned that the hull of this tank may be too wide relative to its length. And I sort of agree with that from a purely aesthetical point of view. However, like I said, my design philosophy is form follows function, and that is basically what has happened here. So, and I can show you how that goes a little bit. You have here the turret, and I try to build the turret as small as possible, and then the turret has a certain width, especially this part beneath, which sticks in the hull. That's the width that the hull needs to have at a minimum, and actually the hull needs to be a little bit wider, because besides this diameter of the turret, it also needs to have some tracks. So, and that's exactly the width of the tank. The diameter of the turret plus the tracks, that is the width of the of my tanks. And now, of course, you could say, just make the tank a little bit longer to make it look a little bit better. But the longer you make a tank, the worse they impact the driving characteristics. And it mainly happens in two ways. The first is, when the tank traverses, and traversing is a very energy intensive movement for a tank, which involves a lot of friction, the forces are wrong. The forces are only right at the center of the tank. So for instance, if this is the center of the tank, then the force exerted over here and on the other side over here, those are efficient forces. But the forces exerted at the extremities of the tank, of the track, those are in the wrong direction, or not exactly the right direction. And also, the longer the base of the tracks, the more surface area the tracks have, and the more surface area is in contact with the ground, right? So the longer the tracks, the more resistance the tracks have, especially when traversing. So if you wanted a LEGO tank which has limited power to work with to traverse on rough terrain properly, you can't make it very long because it just won't traverse anymore. The power you need is too much for it to work anymore. And that's why I choose to make my tanks relatively short, just so that it will traverse nicely on rough terrain. And I really don't need a lot of space in front and in the rear, right? So that's what I want to say about the shape of the tank, the width and the length. Finally, I would like to talk a little bit about another modification I made, and that is related to what I was talking about. With this, with LEGO tanks being, or especially heavy LEGO tanks being a little bit underpowered. If you compare this tank to the Mark VI, then you just because I used Mindstorms elements in here, which are quite a bit heavier, it was unavoidable that the tank in its entirety became about half a kilo heavier than the Mark VI, which is quite a lot of weight. When you're working with pretty weak LEGO motors. So what I decided to do is try to modify the power function systems a little bit so that I get a little bit more power out of them. And I did that by modifying the battery pack in two ways. The first thing I did is add two battery sockets. So when you add batteries in series, the voltage gets added, and in this case the normal power function systems is a 9-volt system, and by adding two battery sockets I add another 3 volts to that, and I get 12 volts in total. And of course that is a little bit risky because the power functions motors are designed to work at 9 volts, and if you put 12 volts on them, you can expect that the life expectancy will diminish. So also you need to be aware that when doing these modifications, any warranty you may have will be void. The life expectancy will diminish, and there's a possibility that one of your components may actually break by doing these modifications. So please be aware, if you want to try something like this, be aware of the risks, inform yourself what you're doing, above all, don't blame me for something when something goes wrong. So there's a second modification I did, which is even a little bit more risky, and that is these battery packs have a fuse in them. There's a fuse that limits the current that flows through the system, and these fuses can trip as low as 500 milliamps or 800 milliamps. Which is not a lot of current to work with. And especially I noticed that when I was driving my Mark 7 for the first time, and I would traverse the hull, which is a power intensive movement, and then I would notice that the fuse would trip, and then the tank would stop moving, which is of course not something you wouldn't like to see with a LEGO tank. So I decided to bridge the fuses, and that means you basically take it out of the system, take it out of the circuit, and the fuse doesn't affect the system anymore. It won't break the circuit anymore. Of course, this is a very dangerous thing to do, because these fuses are designed to be the weakest link in the system, and also they are designed to fail. So it's no problem if they fail. They will just sort of cool down again, and then they will re-engage themselves and you can use it again. So nothing will break. If you remove the weakest link that is designed to fail from the system, then the next weakest link in the system that fails is probably not designed to fail, and that will then result in damaging that part. So that's why it's very important that you are very careful when you do these modifications and especially know what you're doing. I have made this modification, and all I can say is I have had no problems with it. I've driven it for like a week, a couple of hours a day, and I had no problems with it. But that won't mean that you won't have any problems with if you do a modification like this. It's just basically not a smart idea to remove a safety feature from the system. But I like performance, so I can't help myself, right? Okay, that's basically everything I wanted to talk about today. Thank you for watching. I would always like to hear your feedback. And also, if there's something you would like to know about a certain aspect of my LEGO tanks or in general. And if you're, like I mentioned, if you're more interested in building your own LEGO tanks, I've made two very nice videos. One is about the suspension of LEGO tanks, and the other is about shooting mechanisms. And of course, there is a very cool video about this tank, which is called the Mark 7 Athena. And I made a little story about that, and you can see it in action in this video, which is really cool, I think. So that's all about what I wanted to say today. Thank you for watching, and I hope to see you next time soon.